Oh, yeah. Welcome, everybody, to another edition of Outside Looking In. My name is Bruce Snegger, and we're talking about the issues that emanate from Montgomery County and beyond. How you doing today? I'm doing all right, sitting here about 6 o'clock, get myself a Coors Light. What do you mean a Coors Light? That's right, I switched it up. I had a Coors Light in Canada about 4 or 5 weeks ago. It was really hot up there. I just visited the production facility that we work with at Z-Card. The guys take me out, and they're like, hey, Bruce, let's get a beer. Guy orders a Coors Light in this glass. It looked frosty. It was the perfect picture. I was like, let me try a Coors Light. And it was good. I was shocked. I was amazed. I think it's because it's cold. And cold and Coors Light is like alcohol-infused water, right? So I was like, let's try some Coors Light, switch it up. Because you all think I'm predictable. I am not predictable. I go here. I go there. I'm everywhere. I'm like Roy Kent. So anyway, I had an odd occurrence last night. I went to a music concert. I went to see Dierks Bentley. And I want to give you the review. It was good. That's right. It was good. I enjoyed myself. It has been so long since I've actually enjoyed myself at a concert that I can't tell you. So I won't. But anyway, I went to see Dierks Bentley. Vanderbilt graduate, by the way. Pretty amazing. You know, it's like, back in the day, you had to choose music or education. Now, just choose a school near Nashville or in Austin. And they can play in the middle of the day, especially in Nashville. You go down to Nashville, Broadway, the bars open at 10 o'clock. So you have all your classes till about lunchtime. And then you can play for 2 or 3 hours down on Broadway for a tip jar and then come back and do your homework. You don't need to choose anymore. Dad, I want to be a rock and roll star. Well, get an engineering degree while you're at it. Go down to Nashville. See ya. Bye-bye. Anyway, it was a really, really good concert. And Dierks Bentley, if you don't know, is a country artist. You know, we have that country swing. And my wife and I were like, we want to see this guy, and we've never had the chance to see him. And you might not know about him, but he's got 22 number one hits. 22. And he's got a personality. It was a good place to see him. We went to Merriweather out in Columbia. It was pouring. It was terrible. The weather was junk. But guess what? I got caught in the rain last year watching Kenny Chesney at Merriweather. And I said to my wife, this will never, ever happen again. It's like, you know, when you get out of college, you stop drinking cans and start buying bottles of beer or something to that effect. No more Old Crow, you buy Jack Daniels. Well, that's what happened to me at the age of, I don't even know what age, in my 50s. Last year, I decided I am going to no longer sit on the lawn because this concert was actually affordable. We were underneath, close to the stage, which I was surprised about. I didn't think I was that close. This place, Merriweather's not that big, so it wasn't drawn to scale. And I was right up front, or close to up front. Really enjoyed the show. And you know what else I enjoyed? He was a great performer. It was easy to get into. Only bought one beers, and the beers were only $12 there. Shocking. Shocking, I tell you. Only $12 beer. $18 in, you know, Three Rivers Stadium there in Pittsburgh, in Heinz Field of Pittsburgh. $18. So Gene and I, you know, we had a beer each. Moderation, baby, moderation. And then when we drove home, we were out of there within like 10 minutes. I've never seen it so empty. I totally enjoyed myself, and I got home without any of that aggravation. You know, when you go to a concert, you're like, oh, I'm done. Ugh. Concert was wonderful, but getting home just drives me nuts. All great. All great. Hooray, right? You thought I was going to say something bad, but no, not everything's bad in my life. I don't complain about everything. Matter of fact, I'm sick and tired about people who complain about stuff. WFAN up here in New York has a couple guys trying to make their bones on the radio, right there. So they come out, and they come out with these arguments about how the Mets stink or the Yankees stink, and they get so angry and upset about it. I'm like, dude, it's sports. And, you know, and the thing is, you know, you can't even throw a baseball, and you're the one complaining about it. And you know that's true. Half of these guys who were behind a microphone in sports radio haven't played. You know, and then the ones who have played, you know, they have their opinions and everyone defers to them, even if their opinions are not right. I don't know. I just don't like that angry person just for the hell of it. You know, oh, let me tell you, this is terrible. It stinks. At least I try to balance my stuff out. I mean, there is stuff that annoys me and I know it. And I know I can sound curmudgeonly on this program, but at least I try to balance it out, at least in my opinion. I'm the curmudgeon that you actually want to hang out with because I think I'll make you laugh. My anger is funny. It's not misdirected. And just understand, if I'm angry at something, you should be too. But I was thinking last night, Merriweather, what a great concert venue. You know, it's small enough, but big enough. It's like San Dimas. It's all different, but the same. San Dimas High School football rules. But I was thinking about best concert series, right? Or best concert places I've been to. MSG is still great. I love going to MSG. I love going to Madison Square Garden for anything. You know, there might not be any pre-gaming. You go to the Mustang Sally's or Mustang Harry's right on 28th Street and 7th. You go there, have a few beers, spend a little bit too much, but then you go into the garden, and then you get out of the garden, you're back on the subway, and you're home. Right? That's if you live in the city, because when I lived in the city, it was awesome. It took me 10 minutes to go to Ranger games or concerts or anything. 10 minutes up, 10 minutes back. Merriweather was really good. Sometimes it can get really crowded. You know, if the lawn is really crowded, then the parking lots can get crowded. But there's a place in Atlanta, Georgia, Chastain. That was one of the most interesting places I've ever seen. You can open up there if you get floor seats. It was like built out of stone kind of thing. And you could sit there and have picnic dinner, or you could have, it was just a nice place. Everybody's going to tell me Red Rocks and or the Sphere. And I'm sure you're right. I'm just not going there. I'm not going to Colorado to spend $22,000 to watch a concert there. But it was an odd occurrence. I enjoyed myself. I liked it. I was happy. And it's good. I deserve to be happy. So all you people, when you're out there listening to this program or you see me, make me happy, all right? Do yourself a favor. Make me happy. So I told you just before like August 1st, it was July 28th, July 30th, whatever. And I felt like the summer was over. My son was coming home from his 7 weeks as a counselor at a sleepaway camp. The other son was around, starting to get school emails and all this kind of stuff, hearing about school on school ads from Target. You know, I don't understand. Why can't everybody go to school at the same time in the United States? Why do we have staggered times? I'm still trying to figure out. Well, it's because they didn't have air conditioning down in Florida. Okay, but why do they have to go to school August 5th? Why is Atlanta, Georgia going to school on August 1st? Why? We have all these states, and we're supposed to be, you know, I doubt I appreciate it anymore. I used to appreciate that each state was different inside the Union of America, of the United States. But now, everybody's got different liquor rules, different rules for this, different times you go to school, all that, you know, some uniformity. Our main drags are all uniform. We got a Chick-fil-A, we got a McDonald's, you know, we got a Wendy's. And a Taco Bell somewhere. All of our main streets look the same, but all of our rules and all of our laws are all different. I hate it. I want some uniformity when I travel around, but I guess I've been traveling around a lot. And it's interesting to see different places. Talking today in the Wall Street Journal about why all the VPs, this is going to be the only part of the program that gets political. And it's just observational. It's not political. We're not taking sides or anything of that sort. But they sort of confirmed what I was talking about. I said that nobody listens to Middle America, right? Every 4 years. And that's what the article was about in the Wall Street Journal, talking about how vice presidents are going to be picked from like Minnesota and Ohio and Indiana and all these Midwest states, because no one gives a damn about them until there's a presidential election. And then all of a sudden, their economies are booming, or the advertising agencies' economies are booming inside these states because all the money goes in there, all the political ads, all the stuff. You know, if I were a Democrat, and I'm serious about this, if I were a Democrat, even if I knew I was going to lose a state, I would actually go into a red state and have a rally and talk to the people to say at least I came to you. I've come to you, even though this might have been a waste of money. Based on voting records and how purple or red or blue your state is. But I've come here to talk to you because no one does. And I would feel different. I'd be like, okay, good for him. Good for him. I get it. Because a couple weeks ago, I was talking about Obama. And this is my problem with Obama coming to New York. I told you that whole story about the airport and et cetera. But Obama used to come to New York constantly. And it was always for fundraising. It was never for anything that was substantive. There was nothing, there was no school opening. No, you know, everyone makes fun of George Bush going to Florida on September 11th and reading to kids. You know, he was there on a press junket, but the kids were like, oh, the president's here, going to riff, you know. Reading is fundamental. This is awesome. So is the president. But anyway, Obama comes up here, never actually went to Harlem. You know, you got the first inspirational, you have an African-American president. It's inspirational. I don't ever think he used that inspiration, at least around New York. I don't know. All right, I said I wasn't going to get political. Let's bring it back. But anyway, the point is, it's going to be Pennsylvania. And they said, you know, Pennsylvania is not really the Midwest. Well, you know what? When you get to Pittsburgh and left, it is. Pennsylvania, Ohio, Michigan, and Minnesota, and they, a couple others. But it's just, I mean, this is where the election's going to be won, in these states, because they are not set. They're more in the middle, because they have the big cities and they have rural. They were saying today that Pennsylvania is the third largest rural state, or has the third largest rural area of all the states. It doesn't shock me, because you'll have Pittsburgh and you have Philadelphia. And in the middle, you drive the Pennsylvania Turnpike, you know it's rural. Because if you miss your turn, you have 45 miles to the next exit. I mean, that's rural. There is nothing in between. Nothing. That should tell you something. But the point being, America, you know, everyone wants to poo-poo the middle states. Start talking to him before the presidential election, and maybe you'll garner something out of it. If you're a candidate, that's where you need to be. You don't need to be in Iowa from some straw poll. That's nonsense. You know, I don't like how Iowa dictates who the leader in the primaries are going to be, or New Hampshire. You know, it's like they hold on to this. I'm a traditionalist, but they hold on to this stuff like it's a coat, and they will not get rid of it. Dude, you got holes in your sweaters. Get it out of here. Get the coat. The coat's too short. Gone. We've outgrown that system. We have outgrown it. But as I said, you know, the marketers know F-150 commercials every Sunday during a football game. They know who they're going after, the middle part of that country. That's who dictates where the president comes from. You can be from New York and L.A. If you have a Republican, ha ha ha. If you have a Democrat, it's more like, oh, yeah, I told you so. We're hip, 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 hip. I can't even speak for them. I don't even know how to sound blue-blooded, etc. But that's the story with that. That's the end of the political talk. So you can turn back on. You can get your wife back into the room. You can get your friends. I'm done with the political talk. And you know why? Because I'm sick of it myself. I'm really sick of it. Someone just say something. Kamala, get out in the street. Stop reading off a teleprompter. You know, extemporaneous. I want to see someone on their feet being able to answer a question. That's what I want to see. Trump, why are you losing your way? Just stick to what you got. Stop attacking her as a dingbat or whatever. Stick to what you got and what your record is to run on. And there we go. I'm done now. I guess the word is tangential, so I'm getting back to the point I was making. It feels like the summer is over, right? August 1st. We get an email from Quince Orchard High School. There's been a lot of talk everywhere. The governor of Virginia put in an executive order that kids cannot bring cell phones to school anymore. Or they can't use them at school. They can have them. They can't use them at school. An executive order for the whole state. The whole state. That's something I can get with. Some other school districts are doing it. I think it was Los Angeles School District. You know, that's a big enough school district where it doesn't have to be the whole state. There's enough kids at the school in Los Angeles that the whole Los Angeles is not going to be using cell phones in school. I'm with that. I'm with that. So my kids get home. I tell them, guess what, Quince Orchard? I just got an email from the principal, Beth Thomas, at Quince Orchard High School. We all know Beth Thomas. We love her. Stick-to-itiveness. That's Beth stick-to-itiveness Thomas. Anyway, she says, cell phones will be not allowed to be used in class, and they can only be used in between classes and during lunch. I told that to my kids. I made a big declaration. I was like, kids, listen to this. News from Quince Orchard. Beth Thomas says you can't use your cell phones. What was their reaction? It wasn't, aw. It wasn't, it was. And that's how subtle the laugh was. It was that subtle, because they're like, there is no way this law is going to stay. There's no way they're going to put this into effect. I said, you don't know. They're saying it at the beginning of the school, finally, instead of like in the middle where you don't have any clawback and you're only going to get in fights. But, you know, that's funny that kids, 15-year-old and a 17-year-old, are laughing. At a declaration from a school because they don't think the school is going to stick to it. They're like, that'll be gone in a week. I hope it's not. I hope the administration finally gets a backbone, because it's a fight worth having. Let me tell you, man, these cell phones are such a distraction, and you know it. I don't even need to tell you. You know it. Imagine yourself as an adult and how much you distract yourself. What are you going to be as a kid inside class? It's like, oh, I'm going to be watching YouTube, Mr. Beast, whatever. Right? It's just videos on TikTok, 30-second clips. What do I care about Napoleon? He came back three times, two times. He'll be, yeah, Napoleon. Who the hell is that? Napoleon Dynamite? Who are you talking about over there? Elba? Where's that? Corsica? Huh? What? Anyway, I was just trying to impress you with all the stuff I knew about Napoleon, right? But anyway, I'm just hoping that they can stick to it, because there isn't a rule at Quince Orchard that I haven't seen broken. You know, and it's not like my kid. If they find my kid and punish him because of what I'm saying on this podcast, well, more power to him, I guess. I mean, it's just stop with the phoniness. If I'm going to give them a 50-50 shot on this one. I would love to give them a 100% shot on this one to say that they're going to do it, that they're going to stick to it. But it will be, I'm sure my kids are laughing. I mean, if my kids are laughing, and they're not really troublemakers, but they are phone users, no doubt, and it's my fault. But I do yell at them. I shouldn't let them bring the phone. I really shouldn't. I mean, I'm as guilty as anybody. I should not enable them. But we all enable now, because it's part of the culture. You know, and when something becomes part of the culture, then it's like, I'm not going to be the parent not to do it. So it's my fault, too. It's my wife's fault. It's all our faults. We're terrible parents. We don't let them smoke in bed. That's good. But but anyway, you know, stick to it, Quince Orchard. That's the point. I mean, you got kids laughing at you, saying that this won't last more than 2 weeks. And I hope it's not a fisticuff situation, because I don't think teachers, you know, they need an administration to back them up. If someone's on their cell phone and this is the policy, they need to go to the office, maybe be suspended or detention, or what was it? Restorative justice. We talked about that before. Code words for detention. So no one gets upset. But I hope they stick to it, because if they don't, then done. Dunzo. I got a kid who's a rising sophomore. Landon's going to be there for 2 more years, and you think he was laughing before? He'll be laughing real hard for the next 2 years as well. Ryan's out, but Landon's the one you got to worry about. So stick to it. Do it. Scotch soda. Do it. So I'm watching the Olympics. I told you my wife, you know, she had COVID, so she's done nothing but watch the Olympics. She's fine now. Everything's good. We were out last night, finally. But we're watching the Olympics, so you get to see certain things, and you get to watch enough. I was watching this guy, Cole Hawker, right, in the 1,500-meter race. It's supposed to be the guy from Great Britain, Josh something, just the yappy, talks all this junk. And then there's the Norwegian guy with all the earrings in his ears, who's, you know, 23 years old with the nasty tattoos and the earrings, and he's supposed to be the world leader, and he's wonderful, and he's a champion, and blah, blah, blah. And then there's this guy, Goose something, I can't remember. He's an American. And NBC thought he had a shot because he pulled out of the Tokyo Olympics because of an injury. But he thought he had a shot, so there's a feature on him. I don't know if he's a Nike athlete or whatever. But all these guys featured all over. These are the favorites. These are the ones you should root for. You have to root for them because NBC said so. Looking at Cole Hawker, looks like, you know, his hobbies are guitar and music. Looks like it. You know, guys from Indiana, gets no press at all. No, at least not that I had seen. You know, there was no, let's go to Cole Hawker's hometown and find out what's going on. There was no Nike commercial with him, even though I did find out. I didn't think he had sponsorships. I did find out that he was a Nike athlete, signed with Nike in 2021 to become a pro racer. So, but he doesn't have a Nike commercial. There was nobody building him up, but the son of a bitch won. He won. Because Norway boy went out too fast. You know, I'm just like everybody else. If Snoop Dogg can comment, so can I, all right? $500,000 a day. How you doing? Wow. But if he can make comments on the Olympic sports that he's never seen, so can I. I'm an expert now, too. But the Norwegian boy started running too fast. He burnt himself out. The mouth from the Great Britain, He just couldn't hack it. And this guy, Cole Hawker, came out of nowhere. And it made me proud. Because finally, somebody out of nowhere, and an American, all right? An American I'm not supposed to love. because you didn't tell me to love them. But someone who is like us, it seems, won the race, won the gold. Under the radar, under the curtain, nobody picked him. He wasn't even expected to medal. Son of a bitch did it. And good for him. Good for him. Because there's a Nike commercial going around that says, you know, winning isn't for everyone. And they got William Dafoe talking about it, and he's like, am I a bad guy for wanting to rub your face in it? Am I a bad guy for... Yeah, you are. You know what? You are a bad guy for doing that. There is a way to win, and there's a way to be a sportsman about it. As I said before, I'm so tired of the yapping. The back and forth. And you wonder why sports get out of control when there's fighting. Because it's like, ooh, I got you. Nike said it's okay to be a son of a bitch. Not a son of a bitch like Cole Hawker. The son of a bitch did it. Now, these are bad son of a bitches. That's the distinction, all right? It's all in the inflection of the voice. But it's ridiculous. I mean, winning isn't for everyone. I understand that. I'm not from the trophy generation where give everybody a trophy, the participation trophy. You know, I always thought that was stupid. You want to get someone a participation something? Give them a t-shirt. Promote your own business. Nourisho Little League since 1926. Not a trophy, but something they can actually wear and use. Not something that's going to collect dust and their parents are going to throw out before the kid goes to college. Or even sooner. Participation trophies. You know how I feel about that. But winning isn't for everyone. You have to have that killer instinct. Yes, you do. Agreed. That's okay. But you don't have to be a jerk. Being competitive doesn't mean that you're a jerk. Doesn't mean that you throw it in somebody else's face. You know, and it's just, everybody just stop talking. You're not cool. You're athletes. You're not the tough guy. All right? You want the tough guy, go over to Israel. Sit on the Gaza border for a little while for either side, right? Put your life on the line. Stop, you know, getting all upset over field hockey. Germany and the Dutch getting a big fight over field hockey because they were all talking junk. One guy's talking junk. The goalie said, oh, the Dutch should be happy to be on the same playing field from us. That's what the Germany goalie said. And then the Dutch beat him in a shootout. And one of the guys goes up and gives him the big shh, creates a brawl at the Olympics. Ah, there's the sport. That's what we're here for. Wonderful, fabulous, fantastic. There was one innovation that I did see, and it was actually an article in the Wall Street Journal today. It's a Swedish volleyball team, the men's Swedish beach volleyball team. Isn't it incredible? Anybody with an apartment complex can play beach volleyball. So all my people were at Lulu's, right? Lulu's Bait Shack down in Atlanta, GA, the ATL. That's right. Old school stories. But we all had apartments. I had an apartment in this complex, Camden Crest, somewhere, whatever. It had a nice pool, a little like rock thing protruding, waterfall, and it had a beach volleyball court. So I told you, when you have Tuesdays off or Wednesdays off, those are your 2 days because you're always working the weekends, what are you going to do? You call up everybody else who has off, and you invite them over either to play golf or you invite them over to play beach volleyball. And we got okay. I'm not going to say anybody got good or anything of that. There was nothing wonderful, but you have the basic tenets of the game, and you understood it, and it was fun. It was just a fun way to kill a day off. And then you dip in the pool, have a beer, how you doing? But the Swedish team, they have done something. They've taken, you know, everyone talks about stuff that's a gimmick, but when you can look at something, it's so predictable, right? Volleyball, bump, set, spike, bump, set, spike, bump, set, spike. That's what's been going on forever. You know who's going to hit the ball. So if you're watching this Swedish team, the guy jump sets, meaning that he just doesn't set with his arms with his feet on the ground. He jumps in the air to set the ball. So if he jumps in the air, he's got two options. He's created a read option. He could either dink it for the guy who's about to spike, or he could set up the guy who's about to, you know, who's about to slam it down to the other side. You know, so he puts the defender, he makes a 2-on-1 on the defender. Genius. And guess what? These guys are in the finals. They're playing Germany. They're playing Germany in beach volleyball. In the Olympics for the gold. I mean, it's sometimes, this is what I talk about, not seeing the obvious. You know, sometimes you have to look at the obvious. These guys looked at it. They're not the first ones to invent it, but they perfected it. This jump set. And I'm like, hey, we're not that good, or we need something, a strategy, a different strategy, because athletically, we're not going to hold up. So let's outthink the teams, and they created a new way to play beach volleyball, which is a way I will never be able to play. So they've just taken me out of the sport. Thanks, guys. Now I got to play pickleball. I was also reading today that Ozempic, the number one user, the number one city for Ozempic is Bowling Green, Kentucky. It's not Los Angeles. It's not New York. It's Bowling Green, Kentucky. They're the number one users of Ozempic. A lot of people overweight, and it's like, oh, we're rednecks. We know we eat a lot, but we can stop being fat, too. We're smart enough not to be fat. Okay. I mean, they probably all have diabetes. That's what the article said, too. It's just not for fat or weight reduction. They have diabetes there as well, so. But the thing about Ozempic, this is the fraud about everything that we're doing, right? Body shaming. Oh, you've body shamed people. I told you about this ad I see in Target, or this photo shoot I see in Target going up the escalator. You know, it's like four women in undergarments. And there's one woman there who really, you could see her face. She's bummed out. She's like, ugh, I'm with these guys. This is the group I have to get into. You know, she's a model. And I'm telling you, when you're a model, you have an ego. You want to be with the pretty people, right? And there are some who know that they're going to be, you know, I think I could model again. They need average looking guys. But I don't think she was happy. And you could see it in these photos or in this spread for Target. But anyway, we're talking about body shaming. And everybody wants, you have to love me like Lizzo. It's not about just your body. It's not healthy, man. It's not healthy, all right? I sound like Gina right now, but it's just one of those situations that, accept, love, be, we're all one. Until we find Ozempic loses weight and everybody wants to take it, and now no one wants to be fat anymore. All right, it's all a fraud. I didn't say I was going to get upset, but this kind of stuff upsets me. It's all a fraud. I want to be thin, all right? I'm not overweight. I'm definitely, you know, dad bod. I hate all this dad nonsense, too. Get rid of that out of the lexicon. Wall of annoyance, there you go. Anything, dad joke, dad bod. Shut up. Work hard, man. But anyway, I want to be thin. I want to look good. I would love to look good for my wife. And, you know, it's going to take a little bit of work for me. I just can't sit in bed and then decide and drink four beers and say I want to be in shape. I'm going to have some self-discipline. What is that? I'm going to have to some stick-to-itiveness. What is that? I'm going to have some gumption, some get-go. What is that? That's right. What is that? What is that? Where is it? No, let's take Ozempic. Everybody, you know, you're a bad person for body shaming until we find a weight loss drug that everybody can take and get thin on. You know, stop it, all right? Just stop it. You can't have it both ways. And you know what? Sure you can, I guess. But what's the word called? Hypocrite, right? Oh, don't body shame me. Don't body shame me. Dude, I'm beautiful. And it's not the people who, you know, there are people who felt bad about being heavy. Or who couldn't do something, who didn't have it. I don't want to, you know, I don't want to sound like, oh, just because you got to get out of it. It's hard. It's hard. I was once 240 pounds. That's right. I was chubsy wubsy. I was, screw that. I wasn't chubsy wubsy. I was fat. Oh, doo-doom. Boom, 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 boom. I was a fat boy. That's right. And then I remember the moment I reached over Gina. Gina and I were having Chinese food one night in my apartment in New York City. And I reached over her to finish her Chinese food. It was the most embarrassing moment. That's what it takes. It takes a moment to where you finally, the light switch goes off or goes on. And you say, boing, I got to do something about this. And that was the moment I decided to no longer be 242 pounds. You know, baggy jeans. I didn't wear baggy jeans because they were stylish. I was still working in rap music or maybe a little bit later. But I wasn't wearing baggy jeans to be stylish. I wore baggy jeans so I could lift my legs up. I mean, they created those for me. It was a moo-moo. Baggy jeans were like a moo-moo for me. But Chubbs got annoyed and Chubbs said, we're going to do something about it. And Gina joined me and we both got in the best shapes of our lives before we got married. We're actually in better shape now than when we were married. She is. I let myself go a bit. I stopped running because of the hip. That's right. That's my excuse. It was my hip. My hip. Oh, by the way, hip surgery, I recommend it if you got to replace your hip. I'm feeling pretty good now. September was 2023 is when we had it. So I guess it's August now. I'm getting close to a year. Getting close to a year. And I really don't have much issue. I don't think about it much. I haven't really been running. I might start doing a little bit of jogging just, as I said, in case I get chased by somebody. But we'll see. We will see. But the body shaming, that's, I mean, the point of this whole thing is, you know, everybody's saying, don't body shame me. You're a terrible person. Don't call me fat. Yeah, but, you know, I'm comfortable in my skin. Accept me who I as I am. I hear you. I accept you. But, I mean, don't promote it. You know, it's like, it's unhealthy to be fat. Don't promote it. And then you got people, once Ozempic comes in, zoop, see ya. Bye-bye. All right. We're in low energy, aren't we? And we're about 30 minutes in. You've been waiting for it. The wall of annoyance. You know what annoys me? Police on a highway. What are you talking about, Bruce? What do you mean? Police who are hiding, trying to get people with speeding tickets and stuff like that. I know I'm going to get jinxed now. I'm going to get one. But all they do is create traffic jams. Where are you when you got that one guy in the Jetta going left and right on the Major Deegan, left into this lane, right into that lane, back and forth, driving right up on people in this way? You know, just because I'm doing 73 in a 65, don't pull me over. Don't make me slow down. I'm driving in a straight line. Get the dangerous drivers. Not just, I mean, if you're doing 100, I'm with you. If you don't give me a chance to get out of the left lane and I see you like 30 yards back, because I'm actually one of those guys who looks at his back mirror and sees what's going on behind me. So I will pull over and go to the right to let you pass. But what I'm saying here is the police, all they do, it's like there's a stretch of 95 between Montgomery County when you get off 200 and up to Baltimore Airport, up to Baltimore. And it's like if a policeman is there hiding in the bushes, police hidden, that's what Waze says. Boy, it just stops traffic to a halt. I don't understand either when the speed limit is 60 or 55 or 70, why people feel like they got to do 10 miles under when they see a policeman. He's not going to pull you off just because he thinks, oh, you were 3 miles over the speed limit. Come on. It just causes, it almost causes accidents because people slam on their brakes when they see the policeman. Oh, it's 65 and I'm doing 70. Oh, slam the brakes. And that's what all it takes. It takes one or two people to slam their brakes to create a traffic jam. I know. How do I know? Because I know. All right, stop questioning what I know. You know that I know, and I know that I know. So take that. Another thing for the wall annoyance, I was driving up to Ohio last week, pick up Ryan. So I'm like, what am I going to do? I'm going to listen to some podcasts and stuff. I've stumbled on this thing called Stupid Fly. All right, it's about history of hip hop from the 90s and et cetera. It was podcasts about it. And I said, okay, I'm going to listen to it. Nothing annoys me more when people try to put an educated spin like on hip hop or sports or something that I don't even know. But it was like, you know, he was a cultural icon and his conscious rap. I was like, shut up with the words. Stop making it. He was a street thug. I mean, and the thing is, I can say some of this stuff because I was part of it. I was part of it. And I know some of these guys. I don't know them personally. I didn't go to their house to have dinner. But all of these guys that they're talking about, he was a socially conscious rapper and he created a new wave that people would not understand or created a different culture in hip hop. Oh, shut up. Your podcast is self-important. That's what it is. It's self-important. Trying to use big words in a podcast about rap music where the guy couldn't put two words together that weren't curses. I don't want to hear that anymore. Putting an educated spin on music. You know, I mean, there are times that we're not talking about music theory. You know, I mean, there are groups that deserve it, etc. I don't even want to forget it. I don't even want to go down that road. We're not talking about music theory where we need to use, you know, socially conscious hip hop. It changed. The culture was ready to change. Everybody's so dramatic and so every record that came out changed something. It didn't. Let me tell you that, especially for the rap music stuff I was listening to. I was laughing because I'm like, they're talking about Grand Poobah from New Rochelle, too. And he lived through socially. Come on, man. I'm not saying that he had it good. But he sure as hell, and this is the best part, they're talking about New Rochelle, and just 15 miles north of the Bronx, or just north of the Bronx, is New Rochelle, a place that had just crack everywhere, crack and drugs and everything. Yeah, people getting high, I know that, you know, not good stuff going on in New Rochelle everywhere, but don't make it out like it was, you know, Compton. I mean, it's like, if narrative, that's what it is, it's narrative for people who don't know. It's just funny, because I cannot watch a documentary anymore. It's like Man versus Food or something on the History Channel, The People Who Made America Great, or The Food That Changed America. They got Adam Richman. The guy made his bones by being a fat guy, by eating the abundanza pizza that's as big as a table, by eating 16 racks of ribs, you know, and now he's a food expert. I'm sure he knows something, but you got to understand all of this, this whole thing is scripted. This, Adam, this is the points we want you to make while you're talking. He's not an expert. He's just filling time because they don't have enough reenactors. I mean, they have people on Rolodex that they call up. CNN needs someone to talk to somebody about something. I had a guy who used to be an agent for that. To be, it's like, they need someone to talk about the transit system in New York City. Well, you rode the subway. Well, how about you get, here's a card, call them up. Fox will put you on. You're a councilman somewhere in New Rochelle. They'll put you on. It's ridiculous. It annoys me. Surprised. And the other word, there's a word now. Let's get it back to it. A word that bothers me. And the word is curated because people overuse it. You know, a curator is someone who handpicks things, puts together, provided with expert oversight and direction by a professional curator, putting together an exhibit. They handpick it, no doubt. You know, but now they're using curated for things like food. You know, hand curated, or wine, or chocolates, or something that, yeah, you know, there's a passion for it, but the word curated doesn't really fit. Even though definition wise it might fit, but, you know, it hasn't been used that way in a long time. You know, carefully gathered, sifted, chosen, organized. And stop using it for, oh, he curated the Afghan collection. He curated the the coffee collection at Starbucks. Hand curated dog food. They've curated a dog food. That's like, stop. Edith, make it stop. I also told you driving, so I had a lot of time to think about certain things. So there's a new segment on the program called Step Off. I'm just going to lay something out there, and this is how I feel about it. If you don't like it, step off. Easy enough. I'm going to say this. Derek and the Dominoes, Eric Clapton, Layla, is 1,000 times better song than Stairway to Heaven. That's right, I said it. Take it, done. Let's move on. What was the big news of this week? Taylor Swift had to cancel 3 shows, or they canceled for her in Austria. Canceled for her in Austria. Why? ISIS. The fight's still on, people. The fight is still on. ISIS, and the thing about it, it's like radicalized. It's not even ISIS from inside Afghanistan or inside those areas. It's people get radicalized inside their own hometowns. And the thing that's disgusting about it, now that it hit Taylor Swift, it hits home, doesn't it? Because that could be your daughter. That could be your son or whoever, a family going to see her. And the ISIS thing, they didn't even want to, like, get Taylor Swift, which is fine. I understand, whatever. But all they wanted to do was create havoc and kill people. Yeah, tell me, ISIS. Talk to me about ISIS. Tell me about all of this stuff in the Middle East, these groups that are not terrorist groups. Get with it. Open your eyes. See. Look. Stop negotiating. Stop backing down. Iran has plutonium now that they can create into grade weapons. Weapons grade. Yeah, but let's give them money. I'm going to stick on this damn Iran thing because I still will never understand why we need them as a friend. They'll be a friend and they'll do whatever they want. They're real enemies out there, people. Real enemies, and we got to watch for them. I mean, the point of this whole Taylor Swift thing was to hurt people. Going out to have a good time at a concert. That's the concert I would have been at, right? But it hits home. It hits home because that could be any of us. Any of us with a daughter or a group of girls or whatever, you know, who just love Taylor Swift. That's it. Program's called Outside Looking In. I hope I had enough energy for you. I did speak for 40 minutes, but it doesn't mean I spoke well. Anyway, I will talk to you next week. Program's called Outside Looking In. My name is Bruce Negrin. Hit me up at bnegrinradio@yahoo.com, or look for me on Facebook or wherever, Twitter. What do you need to look for me? I got people up in the street talking to me, and I love it. I love it. I'll talk to you next week.
doesn't go out anymore. Just sits at home and rolls her spastic eyes. But every weekend through the door come words of wisdom from the world outside. If you wanna know about the bishop and